So we're at the height of excitement here at the Jewish Museum. We're thrilled to be able to finally receive all the loans that will form the content for our Mirka exhibition in February. This comprises of objects, documents, photographs, as well as Mirka's artwork, of course, in various media. The sentiment at the moment is in two different types, if you will. One is that sheer thrill and excitement of seeing everything, being able to unpack and experience the art close up. The other one is just being able to switch into the methodical mode of recording everything in detail, in great care, and accounting for every item's condition on arrival. The exhibition is in partnership with Philippe Mora Galleries and supported by Heidi Museum of Modern Art. We've obviously been closed all year. We're very excited to be able to share with everyone Mirka's world of magic, share with our visitors her incredible story of love, resilience, positivity, and open our doors on Valentine's Day, 14th of February. We welcome everyone and all.
We're back on the Shtick with Philippe Mora. We're on Zoom to West Hollywood, where Philip now has been residing for over 40 years. And we just saw a little clip at the beginning of the unpacking of Mirka's exhibition, which is now in full swing at the Jewish Museum of Australia. Now, Philippe, I'm really happy to have you on the Shtick. I've been meaning to for a long time. I have a wish list. You have been on my wish list for years. And this is a great opportunity to get more to know you, but we're going to go to the rest of the segment with some clips of your mother and things like when she was on the Shtick. We're going to be seeing Serge Thomann and also some fabulous footage, which a lot of it is on at the museum. We're coming back with you in the third segment. And you're going to talk about yourself and your brilliant career as a filmmaker, director, and now more recently as an artist.
Well, actually, I started out as a painter, and I never really stopped. So my first career was as an artist. My first show was at the Argus Gallery in Melbourne. I don't know whether you even remember that.
Also, the Argus.
That was my first exhibition in 67. And then I actually made some money out of that show and it helped me get to London. And that's so right. I landed in London in 67.
Yeah, well, you've got some luminaries that were present at the London, all the Clive James, Jermaine Greer, Barry Humphreys, all the people that were famous who left Australia in the 60s, you were amongst them. That must have been an exciting time. We'll talk about that in the next segment.
I just wanted to ask you, Mirka, is this part of your lifestyle? Is this the bohemian central that you display in your art?
Thank you very much for admiring my inferno. But it's a kind of clutter. Some people think it is clutter. Actually, I wrote a book called Love and Clutter. But I think you have to have clutter because every object is a souvenir, a remnant of a moment. And we have so many moments in our life that are neglected. I'm always for finding the moments I don't remember. And this is where I'm very lucky to be a painter because my work sometimes surprises me and reminds me of people or places or emotions. So clutter is very important to me.
Now, I just wanted to talk to you about your hands. There was an article in this week's Age about hands, and you made the fabulous quote about keeping the wonder that keeps the imagination going. You have such delicate, beautiful hands of a child. Amazing.
Well, I am a woman and I should have had hands of a woman. I think it's very beautiful to have the hands of a woman, but my hands are the same one as I have when I was 12. Actually, my father gave me a silver thimble when I was little to learn to sew. and it still fits my finger. So it's very strange to have the hands of a child, but I'm extremely lucky because it means that I'm my unconscious and my conscious, and you can see that I love Freud, but I read Jung. It means that I'm still a child in this very difficult, complicated world. And I think a lot of painters are like that. They keep their childishness. Because if you are childish, you can face the world.
You were known as the fourth son of Mirka.
Yeah, Mirka sometimes described me as their fourth son, and I certainly have done a lot of things for... I treated her like my Aussie mum, and my mum is very shy and reserved, the total opposite of Mirka.
Total opposite.
So my mum, when it's my mum's birthday, she stays at home and da-da-da. I can't even take them out for dinner. Mirka, she want to have parties and things, so I've organised her 80th, her 85th, and her 90th birthday party, where she was still, you know, about 3 or 4 months before she died, and she was still in good spirit. You know, it's only after her birthday where sort of her health went down. But and I also organized Marcel Marceau to give her to make her officier des arts et des lettres. Mirka, I've done a lot of things for Mirka, and especially I got her to be recognized by the French government for what she has done for France in Australia and for arts in general around the world.
And it's more about the culture. The
yes.
culture that her and George brought yes. together, and the arts.
But I think Mirka, what Mirka was doing next to painting, in fact, her painting was overshadowed by her showing her tits and her ass at every possible opportunity. And yes. In a way, you know, I don't know, hopefully I'm not being too irreverent, but
it's
Mirka,
okay.
She did flash her tits at one of my fundraising lunch. At François, Mirka Mora estate owns everything. The idea is for Heidi to be able to purchase all the best stuff or all the things that you would want to see in a Mirka museum. And and the idea, the plans are to have a dedicated Mirka Mora museum at Heidi.
So. Yeah. So the cottage you were telling me at the end, which I rudely interrupted you about the John and Sunday.
Yes, so John and Sunday Reed. So the cottage where the exhibition is taking place, which is called Heidi One, is actually the house where John and Sunday Reed lived with a lot of other artists, including when Sidney Nolan lived there. And, you know, William, as you filmed, William was talking about watching television surrounded by Ned Kelly paintings.
Correct.
Without quite understanding what it meant.
He had no idea how valuable those paintings
correct,
were.
Correct, but I suppose maybe they were not that valuable.
No,
back then.
Nothing, just another piece of art.
Correct. I know a very, very prominent art person in the art world told me one day that, as explained before, being her Mirka, being her art being shadowed by her naked bum or other things, the day that people will just look at her art, people will realize that she's an exceptional and a very significant, if not the most significant, female artist in Australia of the 20th century. And
well, that's what Willie
it has
said.
Happened.
That's
it has,
what William
it has
said
happened.
At the when he spoke.
Yeah, it happened really quickly. And and they also, I think, what to have 3,000 people at the Palais for her funeral or her memorial. That was pretty exceptional. All the outpouring of grief when Mirka died, which was quite, you know, surprised me.
It's huge.
And the fact that in a week, the design files raised $200,000 as crowdfunding.
The design files, that's the people. Yeah, there's a board, there's a list of people who gave. And I'm sure,
correct. And I said, you know, the Mirka for Melbourne campaign.
Yeah.
And it's amazing that she's touched so many people compared to other artists. You know, because people can see her art at the, you know, the mural at the Flinders Street Station or the mosaic at the end of the pier or in, you know, bookstores.
Not to mention Mirka Lane off Berkeley Street.
Correct, which is just around the corner where she lived.